Just of everyone for me. You are the reason. days we worship you, Jesus. We declare you are the one for us. Hallelujah. Open the floodgate in abundance and cause your rain to fall on all. Open the floodgate in abundance.
I will be taught the word of God today. My mind, Sister Queen, you are not confessing. Are you confessing love or confessing what I'm saying? Say after me, say, I believe and confess.
I believe and confess.
As I've been taught the word of God today, my mind, you'll be fruitful. My spirit, you'll be alive. My spirit, you'll be alert. My body, you'll be in health. My understanding, you produce result. My life, you will not be the same again. I'll be changed. I'll be transformed. I'll be challenged. I will not be the same again. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Give God a clap of offering again once again. Hallelujah. Now let's read that scripture. Matthew chapter 28, verse from 21 from verse 28. It says, "But what think ye? A certain man had two sons, and he came to the first and said, 'Son, go, walk today in my vineyard.'" Verse 29. "He answered and said, 'I will not.' But afterward, he repented and went. And he came to the second and said, 'Likewise.' And he answered and said, 'I go, sir.' And went not." Verse 31. And that's the last portion. "Whether of them twain did the will of his father? He said unto him, the first. Jesus said unto them, 'Verily I say unto you, that the publicans and the harlot go into the kingdom of God before you.'" I don't know, maybe you like that story, but the Lord laid it upon my heart to use this story to bring us the word of God this morning, titled Seven Principles, Seven Rules, if you like, for a Bible-based parenting. What I'm talking about this morning is simple and complex like this story. You know why? When I was growing up, if you didn't read verse 31 or verse 29 or verse 30 of this passage of the scripture, if you only read the first portion of the scripture where the Bible says, are you with me? "We, my son, go." And he says, "I am not going." And he says, "My second son, come around. Can you go and do this for me?" And he says, "Father, I go, sir." When I was reading those passages of the scriptures when I was younger, my thought was like, which of them should have been a good son if you're a father? Do you know he shows us the perfect picture of our children? Do you know he shows you the perfect picture of the children you're going to give back to? I don't know, maybe you believe me, but if you have 10 children, they will be divided into those two camps. There will be a set of children that will always tell you, "Daddy, I will go," but they won't go. But there will be another set of children that will always say, "Daddy, I go, sir." But after 1 hour, you see, "I have not done what I asked you to do. I will do it." Now, naturally, if you're a parent, which one of this child do you think you will naturally want to love? Are you in the service or out of the service? Which of these children will you naturally want to love? No. The two of them did what the father said in this story. You didn't get it. The two of them did what the father said.
Yes.
The two of them did what the father said. Which of these two sons do you think you will naturally have affection for? You are not a parent. I want parents to answer me. Parents in the house, I'm parent to be. Which of these children will you naturally have affection for? Don't discuss it among yourself. Discuss it with the church quickly because of time. Hallelujah. Sir, yes, I'm with you. Do you know? Our brothers just said now that the one that is always very willing, is the one that the parents will naturally like. Do you think it's right? Do you think it's wrong?
It's right in a way. No, yeah.
Don't worry. There's right, no need. Say your own. Let us say our own.
He's right in a way because by the time, like, as he said he would do it, he has calmed the mind of the father. But by not doing it at the long run, is another issue. But for the meantime, he has calmed the mind of the
Lord, teach us. Prophet, if you are gone, which one do you think the parents will naturally love? Sister Lene? Amen. You still want to say something?
Yeah, the one that did it finally.
The one that did it finally?
Yeah.
Are we listening? Praise the name of the Lord. Let me help you a little bit. Now, what I'm talking about again, do you know that naturally our children are polarized into introverts and extroverts? Which of these two sons is extroverted?
The one that
said, I will go and didn't go. And the one that said, I will not go, but eventually went, you look at him as somebody that is what? Introverted. Praise the name of the Lord. May the Lord bless. Tell us. I prefer you tell us. We are still in the service.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah, hallelujah.
I think sometimes it happens to me. Between my two sons.
Okay.
I will ask them.
Thank God you have two sons.
I will ask both of them. Go and close the door. They will be waiting for me to call
one of them to go.
For me to mention one of their names. So if I say, Boo-boo, go, Boo-boo will say, no, I'm not going. If I will stand up to go, but on the process, he will be reluctant, and Boo-boo will finally quickly overtake him and close the door. And when he closed the door, I will tell him, God bless you. Even though Ifani has shown, reacted immediately to go, but on the process, he was reluctant. But Boo-boo, seeing that he is about going to shut the door, say, mommy will say now that he is my friend, he will overtake him and shut the door.
Praise the name of the Lord. I pray that God will help us in Jesus' name. Thank God that the sons are not here. Do you know that the attitude of children actually made children to have, parents to have preference?
Yeah.
Well, from what our sister has just said, I don't need to say anything. You see that naturally, your inclinations and your thoughts and your desire will be towards that child that is always willing to go. Now, my prayer for you is this, that God will always, if you're a child in the house, God will always make you willing to go. You didn't say amen, child, children in the house. I said God will always make you willing to go.
Amen.
But some of us that still have parents, do you know that it's also still existing? When your dad needs something, he knows which of the sons to contact. He knows which of the daughters to contact. He knows which ones will keep promising on the phone. Can I tell you this, church? It is your responsibility to take care of your old parents. So don't look at the children that we are talking about alone. It's also our responsibility. But that's not where I'm going to. You see, I just look at this story. I just wanted to feel you, to show you one thing. That what we are talking about this morning is as simple as this story. It's as complex as this story. Hallelujah. Because what you know that is working, you are happy when it's working. All of a sudden, what you know it has been working for you as a parent start failing. And you are confused. Because it is always a path unknown. Parenting is always a path unknown. It's always a path untested. Every stage of the way is always unknown, is always untested. We struggle with the Creator as a parent, forgetting that God created the child and He created you, the parent. If you allow the Almighty to take charge of our parenting, He will help us. Now, where am I going to? If you are not going to be humble this morning, you will not get what I'm talking about. Why? I put it in my outline. I said, what I'm talking about this morning, do you know I'm not an expert on it? I am learning. At a particular stage, I felt I learned anything. See, if there's any of my children that I bonded with most, it's my first child. Why? When I get back to her, the night I gave back to her, that night at around 8:40 p.m., and I got into the clinic. The clinic is a family clinic. It's opposite, it's near to where we're living. And I got into the clinic. I saw her face. I said, this is my face. I was so happy. I was so joyful. My dad came into the house the next day, and she carried her. And the first song that swelled up from my dad's mouth was, Ayomide, Ayomio. Ayomi Kabo, Ayomi Wole, the meaning, my joy has come. My joy has come. Because I think at that time, she was the first, even though not the first grandchild, but she was the first grandchild to be, I have three sisters. One is, the eldest is close to 60, so they have two children each. The third sister had like four. So I'm the fourth born, but because I'm the first son, that was the first grandchild that will carry the name Oladeji. I felt that was why my dad was so excited. And I said, okay, this will be the name I'm going to name her. And then eventually I also gave her Elizabeth because I said, this is my oath to God Almighty. Now that's between me and God. But this is where I'm going to. Do you know, I took her, I was so close to her that I would put her on my chest for hours praying. She's sick, I will pray for hours. I pray for hours to the extent that when I come into my, and for a long time, you see that she's almost 4 years difference between her and the second one. For a long time, we didn't have any other one. So she was like an only child enjoying herself. I was so close to her that I know her odor. You understand what I'm trying to say? When you come, I know those of us that have fathers, you understand what I'm talking about. When you have affection for your child to the extent that you have, I developed a strategy. Each time I go out, even if I don't have money, I must buy biscuits. Because I know when I come into the house with biscuits, she will jump at me. Praise the name of the Lord. I so influenced her that at 2 years of age, to the glory of God, she will sit down in church and jot down my message. We will get home and she will tell me everything that I've preached about for years. Things that I believe about, things that I'm passionate about, she's passionate. You can't come into our house and put on any kind of music. My 2-4-year-old child will tell you, Dad said, that is a bad song. You can't listen to bad song in our house. But you know, all of a sudden, she became a teenager. And she's telling me, Dad, why are you telling me not to listen to this song? The question I want to ask you, have I failed as a parent? Do you think I failed? If you don't have an answer for me, I have an answer from the Lord. I am in another phase of parenting. It is now the responsibility I've taken her to a stage. Now I need to allow God to give her the convictions that he has given me, if I'm going to succeed with her. If you believe me, clap your hands. If you don't, don't worry. Now this is where I'm going to. What I'm talking about, I want every one of us to be humble. Do you know why? Late Archbishop Percy in Daosa said something. He said, don't be too humble to imitate those who have failed. The only person that has right to criticize you and you listen is the only one that has done twice what you are trying to do once. In other words, listen to me. It is arrogance for somebody who has never raised a teenager to try to cancel a parent that is raising a teenager. It is arrogance for me to try to cancel a parent. Well, if you know you are led by the Spirit to do it, praise the name of the Lord. But we all need to be humble. It is arrogance for somebody who has never dealt with in-law issue as a parent, try to force his opinion on somebody who is dealing with in-law issues with his children. If you have never had a child before, please, I beg you in the name of God, be humble. Because the way you're going to raise children that are children is different from the way you're going to, from age 1 to 5 is another phase. From 5 to 12 is another phase. From 12 to 19 is another phase. Do you know my mother? My father is so young, outgoing. My mother is so withdrawn. So my father may say, he may be busty, he may say things that he will not do. But when my mother says he's going to do something once, she's going to do it. And naturally, I fear my mom more. Because if my mom says, I will eat you with this thing, she's so introverted. But she's so principled and determined and calculated. So I fear that naturally more. Do you know, as tough as my mom is now, she, you know, I don't know, maybe you understand my language, but she's respecting me now because I'm the parent. You know, somebody that you know, some of us have father that when your father shout and say, you will run somewhere. But now you are the one taking care of them, you have become an adult, and suddenly they started saying, you understand what it, your parent that you fear so much, I've started respecting you. Sometimes my mom, my mother-in-law will be respecting my wife, but that woman is so tough. So I'm wondering, what is the secret behind it? Because they realize that there's a new phase. Respect these children, they are no more under your care. So life is in stages, like Bishop Oyedepo used to teach us, and men are in sizes. May God help us to be humble in whichever phase that we are fine, we find ourselves. Look at 1 Kings chapter 20 quickly. 1 Kings chapter 20. 1 Kings chapter 20 verse 11. He says, and the king of Israel answered and said, let not him that girded on his harness boast himself as he that is putting it off. Do you understand this scripture? He's telling us in life, If you are just putting on the armor to go and fight a battle, don't compare yourself and don't equate yourself with somebody who has just returned from the battle. Because we are not the same. If you have never been a parent, be careful in criticizing those who are struggling with one issue or the other with parenting. Now let's go to something God taught me. I know that a lot of when I was growing up, I grew up in the environment where this young man grew up, the church environment, because we've had some discussions. Brother B, in the environment where we grew up, that church where we grew up, do you know they believe that pastors' children are stubborn? In the environment where he grew up, thank God for him, he's still carrying his Bible. Clap your hands for his life. He's a pastor's child, but he's still carrying his Bible. Do you know there are pastor's children who doesn't want to carry Bible again? Yes. What happened to them? What went wrong somewhere? So now we have two camps in the church. The camps that believe that all pastor's children must end up. Please, can I just tell us this? Pastor's children are not pastor's children in the way you are looking at them. If you keep looking at them as pastor's children, you will place the expectation that God has not placed upon them upon them. Look at them as God's children so that God can deal with them. Now, this is where I'm going to. When I was growing up as a minister, I had two choices. I had the choice of modeling my life after Eli or modeling my life after Philip. Don't forget that Eli had difficult sons and he couldn't handle them. But don't forget also that Philip had four daughters who prophesied. Clap your hands and say, praise God. So if your choice, if you want to believe that as you'll be Haley who had difficult children or have daughters who will become what? Prophetesses. Now what is my lesson? As I kept on looking at the story of Eli, I don't want to ignore the fact that the truth is Eli's story. But this is what the Lord told me. Don't ignore people's complaint about your child or children. Number two, don't precondition your mindset or imagination that every pastor's child or every child of a minister in the church will turn out to be bad. Be careful not to do that. Every pastor should learn to resign their children from the altar if they mistakenly find themselves on the altar before God resigns them. Every pastor should resign their children from the altar. That was Eli's mistake. His children found themselves on the altar. And everybody was complaining that these children are supposed not to be on the altar. The father should have said, my son, resign. He wouldn't have lost the two of them in one day. If he had made sure that he ensured that they resigned from the altar. But he didn't do that. So he lost the two of them. The top lesson God told me is this. He said, let God, not you, call your children to the altar. Don't force them to the altar. Let God, who is their creator, call them to the altar. Because when God calls them to the altar, they will last on the altar. You know, this is practical. Something happened to my first daughter recently, and she told everybody, I'm not singing, I'm not doing this again. I kept quiet. For 1, 2, 3 weeks, I kept praying. I was so disturbed. I was so disturbed and disturbed and disturbed until God told me and said, look, allow me to put her on the altar for her to last on the altar. So I kept quiet. I didn't tell her to do anything. Then she started noticing some things personally, spiritually. And she went to her mom and told her mom. And she said she felt it is because she's no more serving on the altar. That was why God is dealing with her that way. I didn't know. Eventually she said, God said I should go back to the altar. And when I heard about it, I'm telling you I heard about it. I asked, who asked me to go to the altar? He said, God. Are you sure? He said, God. Then go. Clap your hands if you believe me. I pray that she will last on the altar.
Amen.
And I made her realize that I didn't put you on the altar. If God put you on the altar, he will keep you on the altar. So we need to learn all these little things. And when we have challenges with our children, let's learn to go back to God who created them. See, I've told you the story before. The story of a man who had a brand new car and he couldn't handle the car. And because he couldn't handle the car, he went to, you know, he was almost giving up. But suddenly he noticed an old man that came around. And the old man said, what's wrong with your car? He said, this is a brand new car. What happened? He said, no, I couldn't know. Okay, the old man told him, I said, get into the car. Open your bonnet. He opened his bonnet. The old man fiddled with some things on the car and went back. I told him, I said, crank your engine. The young man was looking at me. I said, old man, I've tried for a long time trying to start this car. I couldn't. He said, put on. And he cranked and the engine roared back to life. He was so shocked. So he went and then made a little, and then he stopped and said, old man, I've tried so much to start this car. Who are you? What is your name? He said, my name is Henry Ford. I am the owner of this car. That story taught me a lesson. God is the manufacturer. You are a product. Nobody knows his product like the manufacturer. Yes, yes, yes. So if you have any issue with a product of his that he has entrusted you to take care of, in whatever age, at whatever capacity of their life, take them back to the Creator. He will deal with it. And that's the basic lesson they will need to learn about parenting. Now let's go to seven principles that I've put down. Number one, children don't want to see their parents arguing and fight in their presence. They don't like you to discuss controversial family issues and issues about them when they are present. I hope you know that. Which school is she going to go? Then when your daddy is arguing, he's going to Queen's College, she's going to King's College, he's going to King's College, he's going to King's College. You think your children love those things? They don't. So the first principle I want to let you know is that children don't want to see their parents argue and fight in their presence. Don't discuss controversial family issues and issues about them when they are present. What are the dangers of this? Quickly. What is the danger of discussing controversial issues in the presence of your children? Do you have an idea? Do you know it doesn't matter? You can play to their advantage, irrespective of their age. At five, they know which of the parents that favors their bad habit. And the moment both of you have started arguing, the ones that favor their bad habit, you'll be surprised, the child will be looking at that person's face. You won't look at the one that is stern, the one that is most disciplined, the one that is no nonsense. You won't look at that person's face. You'll be looking at the person that is always give him what he wants, give her what he wants. You'll always be looking at that person's face. So what is the danger of discussing controversial issues in front of your children? Help me now. I said, don't let me preach alone. What do you think are the dangers? Hello, come, stop.
I know of a family where a child comes, knows which issues to discuss with who and so on, but it's always the sentence is that mom is too hard, dad is too easy. So whenever they want to get something that they know that mom can't allow this, they go through that and straight away they're gone. Why did you do this? Look, dad allowed me to do. So the children will now know how to play very well with both parents.
Any other one? Yes.
I think divided we fall, united we stand.
Divided we fall.
So our strength or weakness and strengths have come together. That's why God brought us together. So when kids see that we are divided and they see our weaknesses, then, you know, it's not...
They will enter into that crack and start living there. When the children see that both of you are saying, one is saying King's College, the other one is saying Queen's College, the children will look at neither of the King's College. Do you know it is possible for parents to lose their children going to school because of arguments about which school to go?
Yeah.
The child will just say, what the heck are these people talking about? I don't even want to go to school. You won't know. You won't know. But the seed of that thing will be inside. It's like these people are not focused. It's like they don't even understand. And eventually in future, you just find them losing out. I pray that will not be our portion. What other danger? Help us now, young parents. Are you thinking with me? Now, do you know the most dangerous thing about this thing is that when you argue like that, I've learned that it validates its validates wrong things most times. It confuses the children and makes them to validate what is wrong. Look at this story, Genesis. Sarah wanted to tell Abraham something, and look at how she handled it. In Genesis chapter 21, quickly. Time, Lord, help us. Genesis chapter 21. In verse 6, Genesis 21. And Sarah said, God has made me to laugh, so that all that hear will laugh with me. Go on. He says, and she said, who have said unto Abraham that Sarah should have given child? Go to verse 9. And Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, which she had born unto Abraham, mocking. And she felt she needed to give it straight to Abraham. Abraham. But do you know, some of us women, we are very, very guilty in this area. The moment you see your husband, you feel he has done something, you want to give him straight in front of the children. Sarah felt the same way. He should have called Abraham in front of Hagar, in front of Hagar, and said, send this fool away. Look at what she did in wisdom. Wherefore she said unto Abraham, the Bible meant what it means. Hagar was not there, Ishmael was not there, Isaac was not there. It was only a discussion between Sarah and Abraham. So she said only to Abraham, cast out this bondman and our son, for the son of this bondman shall not be here with my son. Did Abraham agree? No, he didn't agree. Go on. And the thing was very grievous in Abraham's side because of his son. There are so many things the Bible will not tell you. It is possible they have argued because they are both graduates and they can speak English. So it's possible they have argued. And after they have argued, Abraham did not slap Sarah. Thank God for that. Sarah did not abuse Abraham's father and say, hey, that is what your father did, Sarah, to your mother. He didn't do that. And they left the scene. And because they had handled, see, one of these days, you see, one of the things the Lord taught us as a couple is that God taught us how to fight like a Christian. Maybe one of these days we'll look at it as a teaching for parents. How to fight as parents like Christians. That's one of the things God has taught me. Do you know? God saw that they fought like a Christian, and eventually he came back to Abraham and said, look, listen to what your wife has said. Do you know God is wiser than us? Do you know if Ishmael had lived with Isaac, I tell you in point blank, with what we have seen between Ishmael and Isaac of today, Ishmael would have killed Isaac while he was still young. You don't know. That guy is a strong man. That guy is a wild man. That guy, his hand is against his brothers. Go and read about his prophecy. He's a man of violence. I don't need to mention their tribe. You know that. You know their tribe. You will have killed. So God came to him and said, look, do this. And that was what happened. In another passage of the scripture, in chapter 27, the same thing was what Rachel did. He wanted to tell Isaac in verse 46, wanted to tell Isaac that he shouldn't allow their child to marry. The Bible says he went inside and went and told Isaac all alone between him and Isaac. Come on, say wisdom for our women.
Wisdom for our women.
Don't give it to your husband only like that. Number two. Always consult the Bible for help and guidance. Hallelujah. Always consult the Bible for help and guidance. If we don't read these scriptures, we will not learn. Let's look at Proverbs chapter 13, verse 24, quickly. Proverbs chapter 13. I may be faster now. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 24. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 24. It says in verse 24, he that spare his rod hated his son, but he that loveth him chastened him. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1. Children, how many of us are children here? All of us, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. He said, Father, honor thy father and your mother, children, which is the first commandment with promise. The promise is that your days may be long. That it may be well with thee, and that thou mayest live long on heart. There was a time in my life I didn't quite understand it, but I read one of Bishop Oyedepo's book that told us that one of our covenant rights for prosperity is to take care of our parents. I pray that God, some of us will understand this, and we plug ourselves. Do you know God will always put the resources into the hand of that child that always sends money to our parents? And the one that is always saying, I don't have, may not have. That would not be me. Amen. I said, that will not be me.
Amen.
Oh, you are saying amen for me. I thought you pray for yourself. I said, that will not be me. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Servants, be obedient to them. Now let's look at point three. Your primary responsibility is to your children. This one lesson God taught me. While your secondary responsibility may be to other people's children, if your culture allows it. We are from different cultures. You know, in my culture, somebody will say, If you see a parent that says, help me build my child, help me discipline her very well, help me discipline. They have that adage. They said, help me beat my child. It's not from the heart of the person that is telling you. So that's another culture. And sometimes cultures can be confusing. And the same culture will say, it is one hand that gives birth to a child. It is 200 hands that raises the child. So look at the culture where you are living and see what it allows. For instance, the culture where we are living here does not permit you to help raise other people's kids. Do you know? Raise your own kid. Praise the name of the Lord. That's why Songs of Solomon says, they make me a keeper of vineyard. And there's a tendency for everyone to keep other people's vineyard. He said, but my own vineyard have I not what? Kept. Praise the name of the Lord. Number four, fourth principle. Pray until Christ be formed in them. Pray until Christ be formed in them. Pray until their future is set in place, their hearts in peace with God, and their glories baptized and saturated by God's glory. Galatians chapter 4, verse 19 says, my little children, of whom I travail again and again in Christ, until Christ be formed in them. Can I tell you, church, don't be discouraged about any of your children. Whatever weakness that you see in your children is a prayer point until Christ be formed in them. Hallelujah, church. Yeah. Teach and unteach them. Do you believe that? Did you hear what I said? Teach and unteach them. Do you know that you need to spend more time to unteach them than you teach them? Why? As Christian parents, we need to teach and unteach our parents. But I want you to give 20% of your energy to teach them, 80% of your energy is to unteach them. Why? Sister Queen. You will know by the Holy Spirit. Close your eyes and say, by revelation, and we know. Don't have that attitude in the service because you'll soon be a parent. I've seen it in you that you are like, God, this thing that I'm saying is above my head. It's not above your head. Or if you feel that way, don't feel that way, because you will step into that shoe and you discover that, sometimes, If we don't have a home, we don't have a ministry. It is better for me to throw away this mic to have a home than to keep this mic. That's me. I don't know about others. I'm not as determined to keep this mic as I'm determined to have a home. Thank you very much. Do you know one thing? I was looking at you and I was telling myself, this lady is so gifted that even some of the people you see around you that are producing musical books and all that is just packaging. You are gifted. So you understand that if you have a ministry and if you don't have a home, you see, it would be wonderful for you to go and sing and people are blessed and you come back home and you are not happy with your children. I was coming to church this morning. I said, God, I don't want to be going to church in the morning and I'm not happy going to church as a pastor. No, that's not my portion. You understand what I'm trying to say? So we want to be happy as a man. We want to be happy. We want to be happy at all. And by the time we get to church, we want to meet happiness too. And I don't want the condition of the church to be the reason for my happiness. Hallelujah. Do you understand what I'm talking about? So, Why do we need to spend more time to teach our children?
I think they pick up so much from other things. So you have just told them something. As they grow up, there are contradictory things in the society that are challenging what you have taught them. So you find out that you have to keep correcting those impressions. And there are questions in their mind too, especially the inquisitive one. They want to know why. So
any other person, one more person, please. Why do you need to spend more time to teach them than to you teach them? Yes, brother, quickly, because of time. See, 80% of the time, the society, the computer, peer. Teachers in school, friends, are on teaching what you are teaching them. So it will be foolish to add to what is already confusing them. So you need to establish conviction about what is confusing them, because the society is spending time to unteach them. So it is better to make sure that you listen to their questions so that you can unteach them. Ask me, as a father, how many minutes of my time do I spend with each of my children every day? When I come back from work, the workplace have used my brain, used my body, used everything. I am irritant, I just want to keep to myself. It is out of the grace of the fruit of the Spirit that I'm trying to smile. That I'm trying to answer daddy, as this one is calling daddy, the other one is saying sign this paper, the other one is saying there's one that will always greet me at the door with a smile. I like that one. I collect my bag, but the moment she collects your bag, she doesn't know that most times I'm fasting, I'm not eating. The first thing is paper, sign this. And I'll say, I'm not even eating, you want me to sign? Now this is not where I'm going to. Now, I come back at 7 or maybe almost 7, and then by 9, I want to retire to bed. You understand what I'm trying to say? And I've left the house in 7 a.m. How many of my minutes do I spend with them? Who is teaching them for almost 16 hours? Computer for me. So it is important that the slightest opportunity you have to unteach what they verbalize, spend quality time to unteach it. Do you understand? God will help us. God will help me. I'm not a pro. I'm just telling you my observation as a pastor. Maybe if you have the mic, you will say something as good as I'm saying. So, teach and unteach them. Talk, teach, and work it. Nothing destroys the spirituality of our children more than perceived or actual hypocrisy. Please, let's be careful of spiritual hypocrisy. Let's not discuss people in church, a lot of people backbite a lot, and parents make the mistakes of backbiting. You are eating on the dining, and you are talking about somebody in church that has just got pregnant in front of your children. And you are telling them it is good to be holy. They say, it is good. So when we are holy, we'll be talking about other people's pregnancy on the dining table too. See, our attitude and actions are more perceived as our spirituality than what we are teaching our children as spirituality. So God will help us. In Luke chapter 2, we saw that the parents got angry that Jesus stayed back. But when they got there, they didn't beat him. They didn't say, why should you be listening to the word of God? Because they wanted him to listen to the word of God. If you don't show anything to show that you don't want your children to listen to the word of God, that's what I'm talking about. Number six, don't ignore their question and complaints. And number seven, affirm your love to them in words, attitude, and action. Praise the name of the Lord. There's a woman that have 19 children. Her name is Susan Wesley. Susan Wesley. Have you heard about Susanna Wesley? Susanna Wesley is the mother of Charles Wesley and John Wesley. John Wesley and Charles Wesley and Susanna Wesley are the founding fathers of Methodist. Charles Wesley alone preached, composed over 1,000 songs. Some of the songs you are singing today, and the church will forever continue to sing. John Wesley wrote so many classics. The likes of W. F. Uwuyi are the direct offspring, spiritual offering of John Wesley. Because John Wesley was the first that teaches the doctrine of sanctification to the highest depth. This woman, as you are looking at her, was married to a man called Samuel Wesley, a pastor. They are based in the U.S. and they have 19 children. This woman, as you see her, suffers so many things. The same man that was called a pastor left her for 1 year. Don't forget, how many children did she have? 19 children. So she had to take care of them alone. This woman suffered so many things, but you know, do you think all the 19 children survived? No. We're told that 9 of those children died. But we're told of this woman that she was so disciplined, she was so committed, she was so consecrated, and I close now because of time. To the extent that she remembers that she told the Lord that she will give 1 hour of her time to prayer and devotion. So even though she is the one that teaches those children, she is their teacher for secular education, she is their teacher for spiritual education, she is the one that back then, she is the one that does a lot of things. She decided not to give 1 hour of her day to pray, but 2 hours of her day every afternoon. They call her the woman with the anointed apron or something like that. She told her children that, hey, as busy as I am in the kitchen, everywhere in the house, when you see me with my apron that I'm using to cook in the kitchen on my head, I want to go and pray. And for 2 hours every day of her life, she was raising 10 children. She prayed for them. She also made sure that she spent at least 1 hour per day, or alternatively in different timetable of the week with each of those children. No wonder the Bible, the history told us that she gave us Charles Wesley, she gave us John Wesley. Praise the name of the Lord. I pray that as a parent, you will learn to pray for your children. And I pray that God will help us, even though we don't seem to have been there now, we don't seem to understand it now. When the time comes for us to begin to use what God has taught us and what God will teach us, may we not fail as a parent.
Amen.
My one prayer point I just wanted to pray is this. Father, I don't want to fail as a parent. I don't want to fail. At whatever stage that you have, and as a child in the church, you say, oh, I don't understand what they are saying so much. But one day you're going to be a parent. And let me tell you this, you must not fail as a child. So say, Father, as a child, I don't want to fail. God, I don't want to fail you. And I don't want to fail my parents. I want you to pray and say, Father, I don't want to fail as a parent. Can we stand to our feet and begin to pray? Father, I don't want to fail as a parent. We are sufficient unto these things, but our sufficiency is of the Lord. Let's begin to pray and say, Father, I don't want to fail as a parent. Lord, I don't want to fail as a parent. Lord, I don't want to fail as a parent. It's our joy to succeed as a parent. Lord, I don't want to fail as a parent. Lord, I don't want to fail as a parent. Lord, I don't want to, especially in this society where we are living. I want you to pray and say, I don't want to fail over my children. I want them to be godly. You can fast for 7 days. Can your children fast for 7 days? You can pray for 3 hours. Can our children pray for 3 hours? It is our responsibility to show them that they too, they need to learn to fast. They need to learn to pray. The things that God has used to make you, it's our responsibility to make our children to understand it so that God can use it to make them. Lord, I don't want to fail as a parent. Lord, I don't want to fail as a father. Lord, I don't want to fail as a mother. Lord, when my time will come, Lord, let me succeed as a parent. Lord, even presently now, I have challenges in this area. Lord, let me succeed as a parent. Rima sota kalima shende ke yelebo zonda kalia. Lord, I need your help. Lord, I need your help. Lord, I need your help. Lord, we need your help. Thank you, faithful Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. You know, I close now and I pray with you. I have a special announcement for us. In the month of September, it is laid up by my, I forgot the poster. I wanted to put the poster here. The Lord begin to show me that there are some things that we need to pray against. So next week Sunday, we're going to be praying for families. People may not charm you in this land, but you need to constantly learn to pray against imaginations and thoughts that rise up against us. So next week Sunday, we're going to be praying against those things. And then our prevailing prayer for the month of September, God is laying it upon my heart that we should pray against some generational impossibilities. Tell the person next to you, say, what stop your mom? Will not stop you. And what stop your dad? Will not stop you. That's the reason why we'll be praying in our prevailing prayers. Sister Queen, Brother Frederick, Brother Manuel, and my wife, please, I need to see you after the service. Those are the special announcements. The Lord bless us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's bow our heads for prayer. If you're in the service this morning and you want to give your offerings, can you raise up your hand or raise it up? If you're in the service this morning and you want to pay your tithe, or you have paid it during the week and you want to be prayed for, you wish to be prayed for, you can come to the front. Let us pray. Please don't forget those people that I said should wait and see me.